In Memphis, Tennessee, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., America's leading campaigner for civil rights, arrives to lend his support to a local strike. In less than 24 hours, he will be dead.
Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will.
The next evening, a fatal shot was fired from this window. It overlooked a motel called the Lorraine, where Dr. King was staying. He stepped onto the balcony. Suddenly, he fell backwards, mortally wounded. Only 39 years of age at his death, Dr. King had first come to prominence in 1956, when he organized a boycott of segregated buses in Montgomery, Alabama. His home was bombed, but within a year, black and white passengers sat side by side on the buses. He turned his attention to other obvious areas of segregation, such as lunch counters. Amid angry scenes, some restaurant owners resisted serving black patrons. Dr. King took his inspiration from the leader he most admired, Mahatma Gandhi, who had insisted on the use of non-violent protest. Dr. King's methods won respectability for the cause of black equality. As political leaders vied for the emerging Negro votes, he and his colleagues were invited to the White House. Martin Luther King was to be seen rubbing shoulders with presidents, as here with Eisenhower. One bastion of Southern segregation tumbled when schools in Little Rock, Arkansas, were forced by federal troops to accept integration. But it was an uphill struggle. King was frequently arrested, here for so-called loitering in Alabama. In 1958, he lost two ribs when a woman hiding a gun and shouting about communists stabbed him in Harlem. In 1960, he was acquitted of income tax chicanery and had become a national figure promoting the weapon of economic boycotts.
If we're going to be free, we must refuse to spend our money in businesses and industries that discriminate against Negroes in their hiring policy.
His 13th arrest came on Good Friday, 1963, when he led a march as part of a campaign against segregation in Birmingham, Alabama. He and 52 followers were determined to be arrested to draw attention to the campaign, and the notorious local police chief, Eugene Bull Connor, said he was happy to oblige. The charge was parading without a permit. On the 28th of August, 1963, some 250,000 people participated in the Washington March. As well as the civil rights leaders, there were stars like Marlon Brando and Judy Garland. Before leading a delegation to President Kennedy, Martin Luther King made the occasion his own with one of the most enduring speeches of the 20th century.
I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream. I have a dream. My four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.
In response, the following month, a bomb in Birmingham, Alabama, killed four little girls at a Baptist Sunday school. Dr. King returned in sorrow.
So in the midst of the darkness of Mississippi, I saw that little light because of the great determination of the people themselves to be free.
There were stubborn pockets of resistance all over the South, and he felt he must draw attention to them all. In June 1964, he was arrested again when he went to Florida to demonstrate against a motel which was refusing to allow blacks to stay or eat there. But the following month, he won his greatest victory when President Johnson signed the Civil Rights Act, bringing into law many of the measures Dr. King had campaigned for. The president invited him to the signing.
I urge every American to join in this effort to bring justice and hope to all our people.
After the signing, the president sought out Dr. King's hand to shake, a symbol which some powerful figures in Washington privately frowned upon. They frowned even more that October when he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for his stirring fight for civil rights and adherence to the principle of nonviolence. A torchlight procession in Stockholm hailed his transition to an international figure. But violence struck again at the apostle of pacifism in the lobby of a hotel in Selma, Alabama. Dr. King was registering at the previously all-white Albert Hotel when a member of the National States Rights Party hit him in the face and kicked him in the stomach. That incident, in January 1965, initiated a new wave of violence as die-hard whites saw their traditional position threatened. The passions Martin Luther King aroused meant that he faced dangers every day. In March, 2 weeks after the militant black leader Malcolm X had been shot in New York, state troopers waded into demonstrators, aborting a march from Selma to Montgomery. Later in the month, the march was restarted, this time with Martin Luther King leading it, wearing a lei from the Hawaiian contingent. President Johnson had sent 3,000 troops to keep order. By the time the march reached the state capital, it had grown to 25,000 people. But in June, marchers were battered with a club by a rider in a slow-moving truck in Philadelphia, Mississippi. This running man had attacked a newsreel cameraman, destroying his equipment. Dr. King, who called Neshoba County the most brutal in America, voiced his protest.
Why aren't you stopping me? We're right down the middle of the street.
The cars have run into our line. They have beat us, and a man just beat.
Where's the man?
He's around here somewhere. And he ran right by the policeman. They did nothing to restrain him. They didn't arrest him. They didn't try. Now we want to know whether we're going to have police protection here.
Dr. King went to the White House again in August 1965, when a bill was signed ensuring federal registration of black voters. But he was cautious about the effect it would have.
Well, I think that in some areas there will be an easing of demonstrations where there is a real compliance with the 1964 bill and with the new voting bill. That is, if it is vigorously implemented, I think in those areas, we may see a decrease in demonstrations.
Violence still stalked the South. James Meredith led a march into Mississippi.
Sign says, "Welcome to Mississippi," over there.
Meredith had been the first black to gain a place in the state university. Suddenly there was a shot and he was on the ground, wounded in the back and legs. Martin Luther King rallied the marchers and led them on to finish their march. But while he persevered in his non-violent approach, black power groups were gaining influence. Many young blacks followed new leaders who preached that violence should be answered with violence, while Dr. King continued to preach non-violence.
I still have a dream this afternoon that one day inferior segregated schools will become a thing of a dark past. White and black children will sit together in the socially healing context of the classroom. I still have a dream this afternoon.
White extremists reacted by calling for blood, his blood.
We want king! We want king! We want king! We want king! We want king!
This was a false alarm, but the fact that this happened in the North, in Chicago, was a new and worrying factor for him. Although Dr. King was now convinced that his life was in real danger, he continued to preach restraint and to move through hostile crowds with courage. He again took his inspiration from Gandhi, who had been assassinated 20 years before.
I think it's one of the most tragic pictures of man's inhumanity to man that I've ever seen. I've been in Mississippi and Alabama, but I can assure you that the hatred and the hostility here are really deeper than what I've seen in Alabama and Mississippi.
The most obvious of Martin Luther King's enemies were members of the Ku Klux Klan and other white supremacist groups. But which were the most dangerous? There were others who hated him no less and were more devious. Among his enemies was J. Edgar Hoover, the founder of the FBI, who had also been at the 1964 signing ceremony. Later evidence emerged which seemed to link Hoover with attempts to destroy Dr. King's reputation. When King was due to receive the Nobel Prize, he received an anonymous letter accompanying tapes recorded by the FBI which exposed a series of affairs. The letter said, "You are a colossal fraud and an evil, vicious one. There is but one way out for you. You had better take it before your filthy, abnormal, fraudulent self is bared to the nation." King's weakness was that he was a loving father but an unfaithful husband, and the tapes provided potentially damaging proof. "They are out to break me," he told a friend. The agents bugging him triumphantly reported his fears. By 1968, when he came to Memphis to support the striking garbage workers, the harassment had intensified. He was in a constant state of concern that someone might resort to physical action against him. Hoover had always regarded Dr. King's movement as a communist front, and now he had widened his protest to include Vietnam and a poor people's campaign for black and white. When fighting broke out, King thought it could be used as a cover to hurt him. He told aides, "I've got to get out of here." Memphis police were poised for more violence and swooped on troublemakers. On the way to preach a sermon at the Masonic Temple, King had been evidently shaken. What he said there later seemed prophetic.
"I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land." So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
The next evening, at 6:01, came the shot on the balcony. A rifle bullet struck him on the right side of his jaw, penetrating his neck and severing his spinal cord. The next day at a press conference, his lieutenants offered this epitaph.
"Violence dishonors him, for he sought the redemption of men, not violence."
But as his body was viewed by mourners in Memphis, there were riots all over the country. 39 people were killed. His wife Coretta was brave and dignified at his funeral in Atlanta. In his last brooding days, he had preached about death and his funeral. He had said, "Tell them not to mention I have a Nobel Peace Prize or 300 or 400 other awards. That's not important. I want you to say that I tried to love and serve humanity." If you want to say that I was a drum major, say that I was a drum major for righteousness. I won't have the fine and luxurious things of life to leave behind. I just want to leave a committed life behind. Now the world wanted to know who had killed him and why. A police spokesman promised to find out.
This evidence has received most careful scrutiny, and leads derived from it are being comprehensively followed up in several parts of the United States.
The police quickly came up with a plausible theory. A racist thief who had escaped from jail a year before had pursued his personal demon, awaiting an opportunity to kill Dr. King. At last he had found it, and the perfect spot for a sniper's nest. He had stalked his prey, seized his opportunity, scored with a single shot. The other lodgers described him.
Well, he was about 5'10 or 5'11, dark sandy hair and a ruddy complexion.
Well, when I seen him, he was going in to use the phone booth. And that's all I seen. He was in there trying to use it and he couldn't, so he walked out.
He had helpfully left a bundle in a doorway containing the rifle with his fingerprints on, ammunition, binoculars, and a radio. These were quickly traced to James Earl Ray, but the man himself had driven away from Memphis in a white Mustang. An ex-military marksman, he had escaped from a 20-year sentence in Missouri State Penitentiary by hiding in a bread truck. 2 days after the shooting, he abandoned his Mustang in Atlanta. Then he took a bus to Toronto. His plan was to go to Angola via Portugal. The Canadian passport office checked recent identity photos and found his under the name Ramon George Snade. They alerted Interpol. British police spotted his alias on the passenger list of a Brussels-bound plane on the 8th of June, and he was arrested. He was sent back to the USA on the 19th of July, handcuffed to the seat of a jet. He was taken to Shelby County Jail in downtown Memphis and intensively questioned. He later complained that he was pressured to plead guilty or his father and brother would be arrested as co-conspirators. At Memphis Courthouse on the 10th of March 1969, Ray's 41st birthday, he pleaded guilty to the first-degree murder of Martin Luther King. He said nothing to dispute the charge that he was a lone gunman. James L. Ray waived his right to a public trial and said he would accept the sentence of the court. By a previous agreement, this avoided a death sentence, and he was given 99 years in jail. Almost at once, he regretted his decision. Ray discharged his lawyer and applied for a new trial, ready to reveal all he knew of the conspiracy that he claimed led up to the assassination. On the 11th of March, 1969, he was moved to the state prison at Nashville. Although news reporters were waiting at the prison, he ignored their offers to speak into their microphones. If he could not get a new trial, he wanted some other safe place to tell his story. This was that he had been employed by a man called Raoul. They had met in a Montreal bar. After he had proved his competence at smuggling, Raoul gave him $700 to buy the murder gun, pretending it was part of a contraband deal. They rendezvoused on South Main Street in Memphis on the day of the assassination. Ray gave the gun to Raoul, who either passed it on to the real assassin or used it himself. As for the telltale evidence with his fingerprints and identifying serial numbers, this had only been left to point suspicion at him. His opportunity to tell his story came in 1978, before the House Select Committee on Assassinations. On the 15th of August, a helicopter lifted him out of the prison on the first leg of his journey to Washington. But he found a less than sympathetic audience for his story. Ray said that he was instructed by the mysterious Raoul to bring the gun to Memphis. He assumed it was part of a Mexican gun-running deal. it was not true that he had tracked Dr. King for months as he journeyed through the South. He had not even known that Dr. King would be speaking that day. As for the firing of the shot, he said it was not him. It could have been Raoul or some other sharpshooter. He alleged he was nowhere near the rooming house during the shooting, but trying to get a tire fixed at a garage. He took off when he saw the police activity. After Ray was taken back to jail, the committee heard evidence about the anonymous letter which had been sent to Dr. King.
Who wrote the letter? Well, that's a matter of dispute. It was found in the files of Mr. Sullivan, who was the assistant director of the FBI and was heavily involved in these programs. He claims that it's a plant in his files and that someone else in the Bureau, in fact, wrote the document. The document which was found is a draft of the letter, which was the anonymous letter which was actually sent.
Is there any dispute that the letter did in fact come from the FBI?
We've heard no dispute of that.
This confirmation understandably upset the heirs of Dr. King, like the Reverend Robert Williams.
Edgar Hoover and his little clique that are still here should be indicted and tried for murder. And when the truth, the whole truth, come out to the American people, what J. Edgar Hoover did is going to make what Richard Nixon did look like a Sunday school picnic.
In its findings, the House Committee concluded that James Earl Ray was the assassin, but he had not acted alone. The likelihood was that a right-wing conspiracy based in St. Louis planned it, and Ray expected to get $50,000 for the hit. It absolved the FBI, but the Bureau was guilty of gross abuse in its surveillance of Dr. King. Ray never got his official retrial, but in 1993, one was staged for television in Memphis. Ray testified by remote camera from prison. The jury was unanimous. Not guilty. Although the mystery of Martin Luther King's death may never be solved, he left us a legacy. The lesson that if you care enough, dreams can come true.
So even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream.